Well, God bless you. Welcome to our channel. I believe God brought you here today because God has a word for you. You're not here by mistake. You're here by the divine providence of God, because God brought you here because God has a message that will change your life. So right now, open your ears, open your mind, open your heart, and receive this wonderful word from God. It's the first Sunday of the new year. And can I be honest? Something just doesn't seem quite right. You know, typically when there's a new year, there's kind of new energy, new hope. You know, you feel like you're entering into a new season. As preachers, we come up with, you know, pithy sayings, you know, this is going to be my year and all the rest of that. And can I be honest with you? I literally lost track of time and didn't realize that we were right up on New Year's Eve, right up on New Year's Day, and that we were right up on the first Sunday in a new year. Something just seems off. Usually, you know, we're excited about the new year, but can anyone really be honest and just say, it seems less like a new year and a new season and more like just trying to get through the end of this bad dream? You know, the last year and a half, almost 2 years now, we've been at the edge of waiting for a breakthrough, waiting on things to return to normal, waiting on things to get back right. We were trying to come back to in-person worship and we had to make some changes around that. We keep trying to get back to normal and to get back to what was and to get back into kind of a groove. And this year, this new year just doesn't feel like a new year to me. I mean, truth of the matter is, it's been enough to make some of us just say, I'm taking a nap. Come get me when it's over. I mean, you know, some of us, it's between the pandemic, the losses, you know, all the things that have been going on, some of us just feel beat down, even entering into a new year. And it reminded me, it's like a war of attrition. You know, a war of attrition is the action or process of gradually reducing the strength or effectiveness of someone or something through sustained attack or pressure. The goal of a war of attrition is to just beat you down and wear you out until you finally just give up. And I feel like ultimately with all that's gone on in the world in the last almost 2 years, it's been like a war of attrition. What we've gone through over the last almost 2 years has been like just this slow beating down, this slow ongoing attack, this slowly just taking away our strength, taking away our effectiveness, wanting to get us to the point where we just give up and walk away and say, you know what? Enough is enough. I'm done. And with all we've gone through over the last 2 years, as we enter into this new year, as we enter into 2022, I prayed hard to the Lord to figure out what to say, what to tell you. I wanted to come up with something spiffy, I'm gonna be honest with you. I wanted to find, you know what, 22 is gonna be about you. I mean, so I wanted to come up with something. And I couldn't come up with anything pithy. I couldn't come up with anything catchy. You know, it's hard to find stuff that rhymes with two. I got to give Jay-Z credit. Reasonable Doubt album, 22 twos, best verse ever. It's hard to find stuff that rhymes with twos. And this is what the Lord finally gave me. When I stopped trying to be pithy, when I stopped trying to be impressive, the Lord simply whispered to me, press on. For the month of January, our sermon series is simply going to be called Press On. I gotta tell you, I don't know what 2022 has in store, but I can tell you that God has not brought us this far to leave us. God has shown us who He is by bringing us this far and keeping us this far. And this year, we're gonna have to show God who we are by pressing on. We're gonna have to show God who we are by not giving up. We're gonna have to show God what we're made of, that we've got the grit for a God that has kept us by pressing on. We're gonna have to press on this year in good times, press on in bad times, press on in high times, press on in low times, and press on in the middle. Press on when we wanna give up. Press on when we simply wanna go back to get to bed. We've gotta just press on, but pressing on is a decision. It is the decision to simply be persistent. Persistence is continuing in a course of action without regard for discouragement, opposition, or previous failures. And all of us over the last 2 years have faced discouragement. We faced opposition. We faced some failures. But if we're persistent and we press on, we will see the other side. This year is going to require us to be persistent and to press on. Write it down in the comments. Press on. For this month, our anchor scripture is going to be Philippians chapter 3, verses 12 through 14. And this is what Paul writes in that passage of scripture. Not that I have already attained all of this, or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Jesus Christ took hold of me. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining forward towards what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Jesus Christ. This is an amazing passage of scripture. When Paul writes this, you've got to understand all that Paul has gone through. This is one of Paul's later letters to one of his later churches at the Church of Philippi. After he's gone, this is what Paul's life has been like. You know, Paul's life starts off great. Paul is one of the best educated. He's a disciple of Gamaliel. He's a Pharisee of Pharisees. He's a mover and a shaker. He's doing great in Jerusalem. He's a Pharisee of Pharisees. He's on the couch. He's doing everything right. Everything is going well. And then this weird thing happens. On the road to Damascus, he runs into the Lord and he's converted. And when he's converted, he goes from Pharisee to follower. He goes from trying to chase down Christians to now being the most fervent follower of Christ in the ancient church. But here's the thing. He gets in line with following Christ. And to some people would say it shattered his world. He went from being somebody who was respected, somebody who could walk into the temple, somebody who could tout his education, tout his citizenship, tout all the things that made Paul, Paul. He went from that to almost being an outcast. He went from that to being whipped, beaten, arrested, run out of several cities, left by friends who said they would always be with him. It's been long and seemingly never ending for Paul, yet Paul is still writing, I'm going to press on. Yet he's writing, I'm going to keep going. And I want somebody to know today, somebody that came needing a word. I know it started off with me going, I don't know. And I don't know, but this is what I do know. You can make it if you press on. This is what I do know. 2022 is the year that will call more out of you, call more from you, but you've got to press on. You've got to be ready to move forward and press into what God has for you. Press into what God is calling you to. Press into what God is trying to do for you and press into what God is trying to do in you. Look what the Bible says, Philippians chapter 3, verse 12. Not that I have already obtained all this, or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. I want you to understand, Paul is saying, I'm not there, but I'm pressing on because Christ has done something for me. When we talk about press on this month, I want to start today with the first letter in press, and that letter is P. This year, if you're going to press on, this year you've got to start with, live in and live on and move in purpose. Write it down. The P in press is for purpose. This year is going to be a year of purpose for you, my brother. This year is going to be a year of purpose for you, my sister. Because with all we've gone through, you can't start moving in indiscriminate ways. You've got to move in the ways you were designed to, in the ways you're called to, and in the ways that move you forward. There's a quote attributed to Mark Twain. It said that Mark Twain said, the two most important days of your life are the day you were born and the day you find out why. This is what Mark Twain was trying to get at. The day we're born, we're given life. The day we find out why begins our chance to live. I want you to know, my brothers and sisters, you were not born by mistake. You were born on purpose and with a purpose. There is no more powerful thing in life than knowing your purpose, knowing why God created you and what God created you for, because it shapes everything else in your life going forward. Purpose is very simple. Purpose is the reason why something is done or used, the aim or intention of a thing. Purpose is the aim or goal of a person, what a person is trying to do or who they are trying to become. In short, purpose is the answer to one question, the question, why? All of us have asked, why am I going through this? Why am I here? Why is this happening to me? Why have I been gifted this way? Why am I not being recognized? Why covers a multitude of issues? And the answer is always purpose. There is power in why. There was a why when God created you, and there is a why for your life right now. I want you to understand, no matter what you've gone through, no matter what you've dealt with, even over the last 2 years, your why still exists. But here's the problem. We lose track of our why. But this year, you're going to have to work in and work on your why. You're going to have to know your why, and you're going to have to live in your why, because your why will bring you back to you. I want you to understand. Here's the thing about purpose. Purpose allows you, when you've gotten lost, to remember who you were created to be. And here's the thing. Over the last 2 years, a lot of us have gotten lost. Some of us have gone adrift. Some of us have had bad moments, bad times. All of us have, as a matter of fact. But I want you to understand, when you know your why, it brings everything else into focus. Look what Paul said. Not that I've already obtained or have already arrived at my goal. That's far off. We ain't there yet. He says, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ took hold of me. In other words, Paul is saying, I keep pressing because Christ did something for me for a reason. He's saying, I'm pressing on because Christ took hold of me for a purpose. And I want you to know right now, you were created for a reason. Here's the problem. Too often, folk want things to be random. Because if things are random, you have no responsibility. But God created you for a reason. You are not here by mistake. You are not here by happenstance. You are not here by chance. God was intentional when God made you. God was intentional when God created you. God was intentional when God put you where you are, and God has been intentional in everything that God has done in your life. There's a purpose and reason for your being, and there is a purpose and reason that God has been holding you for and moving you towards. You have to understand your why and your purpose to understand who you are. And many of us are lost because we don't understand our purpose. So we drift. We run from this thing to that thing. We do this thing and the other thing. And what I want you to know is God is trying to bring you into focus and alignment in 2022. God is trying to bring you into a narrow path that gets you down the road. And here's the thing. Too many of us, because of the war of attrition that has been, have forgotten who God created us to be. God put things in you from the beginning to fulfill your purpose and the purpose God has for you. I want somebody to understand that God has a purpose for keeping you here. You're wondering, why are you still making it? Because God has a purpose for you. You're wondering, why did some of my friends not make it, but I did? Because God has a purpose for you. You're wondering why you've had good luck sometimes when other folk had bad luck, because God has a purpose for you. God has been strategically maneuvering the universe to bring you into the purpose that he has for you and the purpose that he has for you to fulfill in the world. You are purpose built, but until you know your purpose, you'll always be frustrated. Well, Pastor, what do you mean? I want you to know somebody I'm talking to today is frustrated. You're frustrated with your life. You're frustrated day to day. You keep going, it shouldn't be like this. It can't be like this. Why is it like this? Why is it like that? What's going on here? You're frustrated and you're trying to figure out why. It's because you don't know your purpose. I want you to understand. You think you're like everybody else when you're not. My wife and I, we have two separate cars. Well, I mean, they're separate in that she drives one more of the time, I drive one more of the time. We have an SUV, and we have a sports sedan. Both cars, both vehicles, both have four wheels, both have a steering wheel, but built for very different things. You see, when God built you, you were purpose built. Just like when car companies build cars, when they build SUVs, they build them to be rugged. They build them to sit higher up. They build them so they can carry more people and carry more things. That's why they're called sport utility vehicles. They're useful while they're sport. They can go off road. They can go over land. They can do all sorts of things. And that's what they're built for. But see, they also build sports cars. You see, some company, like I'll give you an example, Ford will happily sell you an Explorer, but they will happily sell you a Mustang. Now, an Explorer is a sport utility vehicle. It's built to go over land. It's built to be rough, rugged, and tough. But a Mustang, by contrast, is a sports car. It's built to go fast in a straight line. And if you option it right way, they even make them now with independent suspension so you can actually make a turn without going off into the woods. Inside joke for the car guys. Here's the thing. They're both four-wheel vehicles. They're both made by the same company. They both have a steering wheel. They both have a radio. But if you try to judge a Mustang by the standards of an SUV, you will always think there's something wrong with the Mustang. And if you try to judge an SUV by the standards of a sports car, you'll always think there's something wrong with the SUV. I want you to understand, because you haven't figured out your purpose, you're judging yourself by the wrong standards. You have to figure out what you were built for so you can know exactly how to be judging how you're doing. And for too many of us, watch this, we're judging by standards that we weren't made for. When you find your purpose, you'll understand how to make sense of your life. You'll understand how to make sense of everything you've been through, everything you're going through, and everything that you find it in your heart that you want to do, but you haven't gotten there yet. Stop trying to judge your life by what other folk are doing, and ask God one question. What's my purpose? What am I supposed to be doing? How am I supposed to be spending my time? Because then it'll give focus to everything else you did. Look what the Bible says. In Jeremiah chapter 1, verses 4 through 5, God calls this young man Jeremiah, and God's words to him are very simple. The word of the Lord came to me saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart. I appointed you as a prophet to the nations. In other words, I built you with a purpose and put some things in you for a purpose. I want you to understand, my brothers and sisters, that God didn't just build Jeremiah with a purpose. God didn't just birth Jeremiah with a purpose. God birthed you and God birthed me with a purpose. And our purposes, while they may not be the same, they are equally valid in the sight of God, because God doesn't need two of me or two of you. God needs you to do you, me to do me, and all of us to do our part for the purpose that he has for us in the world. But in 2022, I want you to understand, you can't be all over the place. You can't do everything. You can't be running wild. You can't be going crazy. You've got to live on purpose, in purpose, and for a purpose, but you can't do that until you know your purpose. God created you with a purpose, but you've got to find it. I know what you're saying. Well, how do I find it? I'm glad you asked. Your purpose lies at the intersection of your gifts, your passions, your service to others, and what glorifies God out of those things. Your gifts. I want you to understand, if you're going to find your purpose and live on purpose and know your purpose, the first thing you got to figure out is, who are you? What are you good at? What are you innately good at? What comes easy to you? What do you do without thinking about it? What do you do that allows you to move and you don't have to think about it? You don't have to work hard at it. It just comes naturally. Because this is what I will tell you, that is the gift that God has given you. And until you know how you're gifted, you will try to work in other people's gifts. You will try to operate in other people's ways. And that's not who you are. And that's why you're frustrated. My gift is preaching. Don't have me singing. Why? I'm not good at it. I can't carry a note if it had a handle and was in a backpack. I can probably carry a note, but not for terribly long. That's not the point. The point is, you have to know your gifts. And here's the thing. Many times we discount our gifts because they're easy for us and we think they'd be easy for everybody else. What you don't realize is that what you're gifted at, other people look at and go, I wish I could do that. While you're looking at them saying, I wish I could do that, they're looking at you saying, I wish I could do that. But do what God created you to do. Figure out what your gift is. Because all of us have a gift. All of us have ability. All of us have things that God has created us to do. All of us have things that God has equipped us to do. But once you know your gifts, what are your passions? Understand, your passions are what excites you. What gets you going? What do you have a heart for? What would you do? What do you do that nobody pays you for? You just do it because you love it. When you realize that your passion, what your passion is, you will never feel like you're working because you will be doing what you love. But this is what I want you to understand. Here's where some of us get in trouble. Your passion and your vocation do not have to be the same thing. I'm gonna say it again because I need you to hear me. Your passion and your vocation do not have to be the same thing. You can be passionate about something and use your vocation to fund doing it. Too many times we want to say, well, I need to follow my passion for my career. No, you don't. You need a career that will provide for you, provide for your family, and pay the bills, and then you can use the time not at your career to follow your passions. Because this is what you have to understand. All too often, we're trying to be passionate about stuff that don't pay. And God hasn't brought you to everything to pay, but God may have given you a gift that will pay for your passion. Understand, Paul was passionate about sharing the gospel. Paul was passionate about making new believers. Paul was passionate about bringing people to Christ. But this is what the Bible tells us. Paul also knew how to make tents. His vocation was tent maker. Paul knew how to sew. He knew how to get a tent together. He knew how to do all the things that created tents because that's how he was making his living so he could pursue his passion. I want somebody to understand, you're frustrated because you think your passion doesn't pay. You have a gift that will allow you to get paid and a passion that will allow you to want to do the stuff that pays for it. Too many times in life, we want them to come together, and this is what I want you to know. Sometimes this is how your passion comes together with your gifts. Sometimes you're gifted to do something that creates enough revenue for you to fund your passion. They don't have to be the same thing. Now, it's great if they can be, but they don't have to be. Because remember, your passion is what you would do if nobody paid you for it. So you got to understand, to find your purpose, you got to know your gifts. You got to know your passions. But now here's the thing. Because it's not about you, how do your gifts and passions align to serve somebody else? Understand, God doesn't give us gifts, passions, and purpose just for us. It's not a self-fulfillment thing. Too many times we become selfish and we want everything to be about us. We want everything to be self-actualization. I'm gonna be my best me. I'm gonna be my best self. How many times have you rolled into a year to be your best you, to be your best self? Here's the thing, maybe it's not about you. Maybe being your best you and your best self requires you to move your gifts and your passions in the service of somebody else. When you look at everybody that God has blessed, everybody in the Bible that God has used, he always used them to help somebody else. He always used them to make sure that something... David was a king of Israel so he could bring Israel in line with God. Paul was born, I mean, he was persecuting the church, then he became the greatest defender of the church, moving people into the things of God. Every prophet was sent to try to bring Israel back into alignment with God and warn them of the distinctive dangers that were ahead if they stayed in their own way. You've got to understand that your passions have to serve others, or else you can be doing stuff that tears other people down and be gifted and passionate at the same time. Your purpose will never destroy. Your purpose is always meant to build. You want to find your purpose? What are your gifts? What are your passions? How can you align them to serve others? And last but not least, how do they bring glory to God? Because at the end of the day, it all comes back to God. At the end of the day, it all comes back to bringing people to God and bringing glory to God. Because you can have gifts, passions, and service that all go away from God. When you can bring your gifts, passions, and service, and they lead people to glorify God, and they lead you to God, that's when you found your purpose. I want you to understand, when you do that, it clears the clutter out of your life. It clears the issues out of your life. It gives you an alignment that says, I do this because of this, and that's what I was created for. And then you don't have to worry about the rest of it. I'm gonna tell you how it works for me. When I'm lost, and it does happen, pressures of life, pressures of the world, what folk want from you, what folk need from you, I always go back to how I discovered my purpose. When God called me to preach, I was confused about it for a while, not just because I didn't want to do it. I wanted to be an investment banker, but because I just didn't get it. I came across a passage of scripture from the Gospel according to St. Luke, Luke chapter 4, verses 18 and 19. This is my life verse, my memory verse. This is my purpose. This is how I figure out when I'm astray, when I'm out of line, and when I'm doing what I'm supposed to and when I'm not. This is what the Bible says, that I've committed to me, that I believe God purposed me for. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Anytime I feel lost, I read that scripture and it reminds me of what God made me for. Anytime I feel lost, I read that scripture and it reminds me, you're gifted to preach. So go preach to God's people. It reminds me that my preaching and my work should be setting people free. One of the reasons I work in finance and one of the reasons I do some of the things I do around godly finances is to set people free from debt, to open people's eyes to how money should be used in the sight of God so they can bring glory to God and be faithful to God. And at the end of the day, I get no more greater joy than to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. I know when I'm lost, when those are not the things that I'm doing. Because here's the thing. There are times that you just wind up doing too much. I'm talking to you. You're doing too much. I've been there, burnt out, about to pass out because I'm trying to do everything in the world. When you focus and press on into your purpose, you will get your life back. And watch this, the life you get back will be life-giving to you and to other folk around you. When I feel lost, I come back every time to Luke chapter 4, verses 18 and 19. We, my brothers and sisters, were made on purpose. We were made for a purpose. We've been blessed so that we can press into our purpose as individuals and as a church. I want you to know the purpose of St. Paul is very simple, same purpose of every church. Go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you. And surely I will be with you always, even until the end of the age. My brothers and sisters, 2022 is the year that we're going to press on. We're going to press on into our purpose as people and press into our purpose as a church. This is the year we will press on. We're going to live on purpose. We're going to move in purpose. And we're going to be about our purpose. We're going to press on. We're going to press on purpose. Thank you for joining us. I hope that message was a blessing to you. Maybe that message was such a blessing that it stirred something in you and you want to get a little bit closer to God. Listen, we want you to be in fellowship and relationship with God through his son, Jesus Christ. If you want to do that, all you got to do is let us know. Go to our website, www.stpauloxenhill.org, and press the contact us button. Once you press it, just say, I want to be saved, or I want prayer, and we will reach right back out to you to pray the prayer of salvation or to pray over your personal needs. We want you to be engaged. We want you to be involved. But most importantly, we want you to have a connection with God through his son, Jesus Christ. Listen, if you enjoyed this, we want to make sure you're a part of the St. Paul family. Like and subscribe to us on YouTube. Follow us on Facebook and Instagram. We want you to know everything that's going on. We want you to know every time we put out content, and we want to continue to be a blessing to your life. If you want to support our ministry, all you got to do is go to our website, www.stpauloxenhill.org, and press the Give tab. You can give your tithe there, you can give your regular offering, or you can make a special gift unto the church. Every dollar counts. Every dollar helps us spread the gospel all around the world, and we'd appreciate your support. It helps more than you know. God bless you. Thank you for joining us. And now it's time for the Williams Weekly Challenge. The Word of God tells us not only to be hearers of the Word, but also doers of the Word. As we enter into 2022, I've got a big challenge for you in the first week. My challenge for you this week is to find your purpose. And I know you're looking at me saying, are you kidding me? It's only 3 days in. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to make some lists. Number one, make a list of the things that you are innately gifted at. What are the things you're good at? Number two, make a list of your passions. What are the things that excite you, the things that give you life, the things that give you joy? Number three, once you look at the list of gifts and passions, how can they serve other people? Because understand, life is not just about you. Life is about what you do in the world. And number four, once you see what you're good at, what you're passionate about, and how it serves people, at the intersection of all of that, how does that glorify God? When you figure out those four things, you'll know your purpose. And this year is the year to live on purpose. God bless you. I love you. And we'll see you next time.